has increasingly become, how do God and religion enhance my life? So why not both? Rabbi Zelos asks. Why can't the message be to serve God while at the same time allowing religion to improve our lives? It is really a question of valence, he says. How much of one and how much of the other? Sure, a little of each is certainly well-rounded. But he concludes, deep down I know that what is well-rounded on the outside is hollow on the inside. The compromise between both does not allow for a more concentrated and impactful message that may change lives. And so he says, I remain frustrated and stymied, as will my congregation, as it gets my well-intentioned but inadequate mixture and continues asking, why religion at all? Why institutional religion? That's what I really need to know. Maybe I can help answer that next year. Gerald Zelizer is not the only clergy facing this dilemma. It appears to be pervasive throughout America. Stephen Cohen and Arnold Eisen pointed to this trend in their book, The Jew Within, which came out in the year 2000 and was based on research done in the late 1990s. They highlighted the shift in American Judaism from communal involvement and awareness to individualism. No longer do American Jews ask, what can I do for God and the Jewish community? But rather, what could God and the Jewish community do for me? Over the past couple of decades, there's been a lot of work done on religion. Sociologists have studied the effect of religious observance and belief on a cross-section of the population. And they have concluded that those who are very religious are in general mentally, emotionally, and physically better off than those who are modest or infrequent in their observance. Other research has shown that an active member of a religious community presents with a boosted immune system and other signs of better health. Neuroscientists are in the process of trying to understand how belief in God and religion affects brain chemistry and vice versa. Like most investigations of brain function, this research is still in its infancy. But some of the preliminary observations reported by folks like Dr. V.S. Ramachandran are proving to be quite fascinating. Is religious belief really nothing but delusion? Apparently, not more than most of our other perceptions about what we consider to be real. And so maybe we should delay rushing into quick judgment. Of course, there are those skeptics who would say that all of this is rather pointless, because one would probably find the same results for people who belong to a country club, a JCC, or a YMCA, without necessarily having any religious component involved in the equation. To my mind, while the research and its findings are intriguing, somehow I don't think that health benefits, whether mental or physical, are at the top of most people's lists of why they will or not will not participate in religious practices, or for that matter, why they would choose to join a congregation of fellow adherents. So what is it then? There is no simple, single answer to this question. Over the decades, the emphasis has shifted between a number of alternates. For many, at least as far as Jews are concerned, there was an intrinsic obligation to join a congregation, unless, of course, one was a socialist or communist. If that was so, then one joined the workman's circle, which served the same function as a congregation, just without religion. Societal pressure was a strong factor. American society, for all of its embracing modernity, has always been religiously conscious. It was especially so in the mid-20th century, and hence the expectation that of course you belong to a religious organization. This societal pressure could be positive. It helped create and provide a welcoming community to assist the new immigrants settling into this chosen land. But it also could be and was most often negative. Anti-Semitism forced Jews to seek solace and support in the shelter of the synagogue and under the protective canopy of the Jewish communal organizations. There was also a strong social incentive to join a congregation. It was where you could find a ready circle of friends, meet your beshert, and other young couples who had kids or were about to start a family. Enrolling one's kids in religious school followed as a natural progression, as was the expectation that they would eventually assume the responsibility of maintaining the institutions which helped inculcate their Jewish identity. Personal practice was not as important as participation in the community. For many, one could happily be part of a synagogue and never light Shabbat candles at home, never study a Jewish text, or know how to spell Maimonides. Despite that, this generation built up and expanded them and maintained their congregations. There was rarely any doubts about their level of commitment, their generosity, nor their willingness to step up to leadership. In general, Jewish communal life flourished. Synagogues, JCCs, social service agencies, and federations all proliferated and thrived. Social action and support for the fledgling state of Israel drew in even those who considered themselves religiously marginal. And then it all changed. Not suddenly, but over 2 or so decades. A new generation arose who knew not the community, or perhaps knew the community too well. They started asking themselves and the institutions that their parents had so unstintingly supported some very hard questions. Questions that pierced the veil of complacency that had settled over the Jewish community. Questions whose resonance set off a wave of dissatisfaction with the status quo. And while millions of dollars were being expended on promoting Jewish identity and trying to address the apparent crisis of intermarriage, very few paid attention to the real problems at hand. How meaningful is religion in general and Judaism in particular? Why should my sense of obligation be the same as yours? What has God or the synagogue done for me lately? For the most part, the establishment was at a loss. It never really occurred to its leadership that anybody would question its purpose, its vision, how it functioned, or indeed its very existence. Congregations are facing a steady decline in membership, and the persistent economic downturn has caused even committed individuals to reevaluate their current communal contributions. More and more clergy are finding themselves only marginally employed in congregations, if at all, so that a la carte fee-for-service Judaism has proliferated. Depth of knowledge and experience of clergy are no longer an important criteria. Cost is. Not surprisingly, then, online and private ordination has rapidly become a thriving industry. This picture looks bleak, but it overlooks one incredibly important fact. Each and every one of us has a soul. A soul that has to be nourished and developed. Soul, I hear you say? Come on now. Soul? Really? Soul is going to save Judaism? Always thought that Judaism was supposed to I see soul as more than just the classic definition of a divine spark that resides within every human. I see it as that which allows us to find meaning and purpose in our lives. I see soul as that which drives us towards the good, that which impels us to have regard for one another in our world, and that which enables us to love and care. And this is where we find the fundamental and intrinsic value of Judaism and Jewish practice. For 2.5 and perhaps even 3 or 3.5 millennia, Judaism has been evolving a way of living that encompasses everything that makes us human. This evolution is still ongoing. It has never ceased and continues right up to this very present time. The main focus of this development has been devoted to growing soul. How does one, through a mixture of belief and practice and conduct, make more and more of the world aware of what it means to be a decent, moral, caring, and compassionate person? Is it possible to universalize Menschlichkeit? It is hard enough to find a way when dealing with a small, concentrated population, as in biblical or Talmudic times, or when the community is ghettoized, voluntarily or involuntarily, as in the medieval period. But how does one deal with a population which is indistinguishable from the general population? How do you reach people who are totally assimilated and for whom there is no social limitations within their society? A particularistic message, one aimed purely at the Jewish community, delivered in the garb of traditional values, concepts, and language, is not going to work in modern America. The challenge is how to translate those values, those concepts, and that language into a form that resonates deep in the recesses of our souls. How do we ignite the sparks of soul that will rekindle the burning bush within each and every one of us? Herein lies the fundamental issue. Judaism can provide the opportunity. It can even point out that the ground is holy and that the bush is right here. Judaism can help fan the embers, grow the flame, but it cannot provide the spark. The Torah tells us that Moses said, "I will turn aside now and see this great sight." Even the greatest of our prophets had to make the effort to turn aside from his regular path, make the effort to open himself up to the miracle of the voice inside the fire. Each of us embodies that possibility. In each of us is a soul waiting to be sparked. For some, the flame may have already been kindled, but needs to be nourished. For others, it may yet be dormant. I believe it is incumbent upon each and every one of us to unleash our Menschlichkeit upon the world. I believe it is Judaism that can provide the mechanism for that to happen. May each of us choose to turn aside from the material and the mundane. May each of us choose to light the spark. May each of us find that holy ground and choose to become the miracle. May each of us ask ourselves this new year, how will we serve our God and our community? Amen.